I'm sure most of you have seen the events in our country this past week. Unfortunate as they are, they do remind us that there still is a lot to be done in terms of our own country, our dreams, our hopes, and in ways in which we try to live those things out. All I can say is that it was disappointing. It's interesting in the gospel that we have a perfect, again, choice for the events that did take place. Canaanites are an ancient people. They lived along with the Israelites. They never believed in the true God. And so you had the separation between the believers and the non-believers. They had an area, a territory of their own, the Holy Land, north of Jerusalem. And strictly speaking, a believing Jew should not set foot in that Canaanite territory. So it's interesting that Jesus chose to do so when he went to the city of Tyre and Sidon. That must have surprised his disciples. But that was only the beginning. Then there was this encounter with the Canaanite woman, who, even though it seemed she didn't believe, had heard about Jesus and approached him and pleaded with him to do something about her daughter who was possessed by a demon. It's also interesting that our Lord at first questioned it and said to himself, I really don't think I should be doing this because it's not allowed. And then I would say, out of human concern for the child and for the mother who was begging him to do something, he fulfilled her request, and the daughter was healed. And so it is then that Jesus, in a certain sense, had extended himself beyond the believing community within the Holy Land to this entirely non-believing part of the world, if you will. In a certain sense, it's an invitation on the part of all of us, not only to invite fellow believers, but to invite anyone who might be interested. The first reading simply says, "My house shall be a house of prayer for all people," referring to the temple in Jerusalem. Jesus loves and is concerned about all peoples, and that we as a church, composed of people from across the globe, must have that same love and concern for others, even those whom we don't know, even those who are not fellow believers. And so oftentimes I think events such as the ones we have this week make us question a lot of things: our own citizenship, again, our membership in a universal church, and then I think for many of us, we just kind of stand back in uncertainty and fear, wondering, you know, what's going to come of all of this. Certainly fear tries to exclude anyone who is different, whether it's race, whether it's country of origin, sexual orientation, language, or culture. All of these things, in a certain sense, make us pause and wonder, how do I deal with the situation that I'm in? Perhaps it's someone who doesn't speak English. And still, there are ways in which we can communicate to them our friendship and our goodwill. So in a certain sense, it places a responsibility upon us to be people who are representatives of Christ, not necessarily by what we say, but how we interact with others. And that, of course, speaks thousands of words. And so we think about the events that I mentioned, and rather than threats, as we heard, instead we should be people who are somehow radiating that universal love of God our Father. There's an impulse to divide and separate when we are faced with diversity. But there's another impulse that should be there, and it should be one of thanksgiving, to say what richness there is out in the world, and what richness there is within our own culture, and what richness there is within our own Catholic faith. That should overcome a lot of those fears and go back to the notion of invitation. Seems that there is an impulse to divide and separate people, and we know that doesn't come from God. That's just the opposite. And that's why our Holy Father said, and I quote him, "A person who thinks only in terms of building walls, wherever they may be, and not building bridges, is not a Christian." And I end, and I'm sure you've heard this before, the beautiful poem by Emma Lazarus. You find that at the base of the Statue of Liberty. And how many strangers, if you will, have come to this country and become part of our citizenship and are no longer strangers. And it's a perennial invitation, beautifully written in poetic form, and I think something for all of us to ponder and to pray over. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of the teeming shore. Send these homeless, the tempest-tossed, to me, and I will lift my lamp beside the golden door.